Ron got his start as an activist just like all of you. Please learn everything you can from his remarkable example of activism success. It's an honor to introduce our president, Ron Robinson.
Thank you, Emily. Thank you. Thank you, Emily. That's awful nice. It sounds like you just wrote my obituary. But appreciate the kind introduction. This actually is less about me than more about your participation, what you think of conservative movement, and we'll talk about that in just a second. But Emily mentioned you'll have an opportunity at some of our conferences to hear some of the greatest leaders of the conservative movement. And I have to say, when I look back at my years as a student, I first became involved in the conservative movement in high school, but in college, I had this obscure Polish cardinal come to my college, Canisius College, and I didn't really know who he was, didn't know much about him, figured, you know, I was working at night, it was a night address, didn't go to see it, and it turned out that it was the person who became John Paul, Pope John Paul II, and missed a great opportunity. I also, in my early AF conferences, heard from a lot of the great leaders of the conservative movement, people like Russell Kirk, Frank Meyer, obviously Bill Buckley, our founder, and others. And I think I had a greater appreciation for them, but maybe not the appreciation that over time their careers suggested merited in all that they had accomplished. And I want to say to you, I'm not the person introducing our luncheon speaker today, but Robby George is that kind of person. If I heard Robby George when I was in high school, I probably wouldn't completely appreciate all the points he makes in his various addresses. He is a college professor at Princeton University. But I guarantee you, in the course of your lifetime, to be able to look back and say you heard firsthand from Robby George when he was in his prime is a very special occasion. And I would urge you to get the most you can out of his lunch or pre-lunch speech, because he really is probably the foremost intellectual in the conservative movement today. Even though you may never have heard his name before, you're going to hear his name for many decades to come. Now, this is about what is the conservative movement. Last night, you introduced yourselves. A number of you said that you wanted to learn more about the conservative movement. Some of you said you wanted to learn what the conservative movement was. But this is a bit about labels. And one of the first critique of talking about conservatism versus liberalism will be, oh, I don't like to use labels. How would you answer that objection right from the outset if someone says to you, I don't want to talk about conservative versus liberal or conservative versus progressive? Any thoughts on that? Yes. So that's very true. Time. Use of labels sometimes saves a lot of time. And I'll underscore that in just a second. I think that's the essence of it. I think it's a great answer. Any other thoughts on this question? Well, I think Shelby has it right. I think it saves time. Let me give you an example. And this is what I would probably say if someone says, oh, I don't like to use labels. It was just a conference in New Hampshire by John Huntsman and some others. I think Senator Lieberman said it was the No Labels Conference. But you use labels in every other aspect of life. If I asked, and I'm not asking rhetorically here, or I'm not asking specifically here, if you have a smartphone, you know what I'm talking about. It's a phone that has some computing ability. If I said you had just a phone, you would know I'm talking about something that you can just talk to someone else but doesn't have the computing ability. Or if you go to a grocery store and you want tenderloin, it's a little bit different than asking for ground chuck or something like that. We have labels in everything that we do in life. And those people that start out by telling you they have some objection to using labels, you only have to point them out for a second that they use labels in everything else in their life. And it is a way to quickly get to the essence of a lot of discussion, as Shelby said, to save time. It is essential to save time, because if you spend all the time talking about, you know, just the specific issues, which you will eventually get to, but that takes a lot of time. And so Often you need that, just like you need to label anything else in life. If I'm going to a formal dinner as compared to going to dinner, you're putting a label on a dinner, it means something. If you say someone's conservative versus someone's liberal, it means something, and to pretend otherwise is really a cop-out. But you're going to have some people who are uncomfortable saying that because they're really not completely sure what the different labels might mean, and that is why we are going to discuss that topic this morning. But do not let somebody cop out by just saying, oh, I don't like to use labels. If you find somebody who doesn't like to use labels in life, you let me know, because their life is like an anarchist life. It would be, you know, defining everything from scratch every single time. It just doesn't work that way. You're in high school or you're in middle school, you're in elementary school, those are labels. There's labels in every aspect of our lives. So what is conservatism? That's what we're going to focus on. We don't want anyone to come to a basic foundation seminar and not zero in on what we mean by the conservative movement, because we use that term all the time. So let's start. We'll start from my right. And who was the spokesman for this group, or the leader for this group? If you don't mind coming up here and sharing a couple of things that you think are most important. And I'll try not to have these overlap. So when it comes to your, if you're the spokesperson for one of these other boards or other groups, keep in mind what's already been said, and we'll try not to repeat. How are you, Ron?
Thanks, Adriana.
Great to have you with us. Tell me what you think is, or your group thought was most important as being a conservative. Give me a couple examples and say why. What would you say were a couple of the most important out of your discussion group?
I think that the tenet of individualism came up quite often.
Okay, yeah.
The freedom to do what you want with your own money, do what you want with your own life. That one was very valuable. Okay. And the strong national defense also came up.
Okay, well, let's stick with individualism for a second. What is the opposite of individualism? If you weren't for individualism, what would you be for?
You'd be for maybe like a communist environment where everyone works to the same common goal.
Right.
Yeah.
So individualism, looking for individual self-merit is important.
Mm-hmm.
This is central to the conservative thought process. And it actually even is probably central to your teachers' thought process. I don't have time today to give you this example thoroughly, but think about the grade system in your classrooms. What do you have numerical grades or letter grades?
I have both.
You have both. Okay. But let's say we're have letter grades, and some students work hard to get an A+, and some students, you know, maybe slack off a bit and potentially get an F. You could have a teacher say, well, you know, you don't need an A+ to get into college you want to get into. We're going to help some of those students getting an F, and there's no longer going to be A+, there'll be A through D. And then you could go the next step and say, well, you really don't need an A, we're going to have B through C. What would happen? We all know what would happen. I usually would ask you what would happen. People aren't going to study as hard. You're not going to cram for a test as much, and the overall effort would fall off. That's the problem with collectivism. When you view yourself as individually responsible, you're going to do a better job than when you're, you know, working, you know, for some collective. You know, there's a famous line that I heard years ago on a trip like this. We were going to merge into traffic, and it was questionable on these California highways whether we could do it successfully. And the VIP I was with said, go ahead, it's a rental. Well, he didn't own it. Not having individual ownership, he could take some risks and not worry so much about it. As an individualism, you tend to have more personal responsibility and some of these other aspects. If you start from an individual point of view, what else is important? What's related to that in this group?
I think personal responsibility and financial accountability, including personal responsibility in the sense of taking ownership of your own actions.
So this would be related to accountability.
Yes.
Walter Williams says the best social program, best indication of social justice, is to do the best job with your own life. That's a fundamental foundation for social justice. Start with yourself, earn a living, be responsible in your own life. That's what accountability, and it's tied oftentimes to individualism. Anything else that's tied that you see as the personal responsibility, accountability, I agree with you completely.
I think lower taxes as well.
Lower taxes, all right. And why would lower taxes be tied to that?
Because when you have more of your own money to spend, you demonstrate a lot of personal responsibility in how you support charitable organizations and purchase things for your own personal gain and use.
Yeah. A lot of almost every conservative and most moderates would say they're for lower taxes. But no one, in my opinion, did a better job of explaining why we're for lower taxes. You did an excellent job, but no one did a better job than Ronald Reagan. Ronald Reagan didn't just say he was for lower taxes. He started with two premises that probably everyone in this room is going to agree with, and he knew everyone in the audiences that he was talking to would agree with it. The first premise he would start with was he would say, the person who earns the money should have the most say over how it's going to be spent. How many of you would agree with that? Person who earns the money should have the most say how it's going to be spent. Then he would say, they will do, or you will do, a better job than someone in a distant capital like in Washington. How many think you'll do a better job spending your money than a bureaucrat? And then he would go, therefore, I'm for lower taxes. He wouldn't just jump to lower taxes. He would build in the premises, which is wise to do. I'm going to let foreign policy go a little bit later, but thank you. You had a good group. I don't disagree with anything your group put up here. Either way, thank you very much.
Thank you. Good job.
This group has already given themselves a mark. This is group A. You jumped ahead, Reagan.
Yeah.
So we've got individualism. We've got a personal accountability, lower taxes. Leaving those aside, what was most important in your group?
I think individual or limited government.
Limited government. So you had it right at the top. And what do you mean by limited government? What does that mean, limited government?
We tied it in with free enterprise and the ability for the private sector to function. And so limited government in terms of allowing people to, exercise their freedoms, like freedom of religion and speech, and then also their freedoms in the private sector and self-governing.
So self-governing, you have self-governing up here as a separate one. Self-governing, absolutely, is tied to limited. Talk about the limited part. Why should government be limited? We elect our officials. This is a democracy. Why should it be limited? Why not unlimited? If we agree to do something, why shouldn't government be able to do it?
Because then the people lose their voice. And then if government is expanded and how the liberals advocate for big government, then the people's voice is lessened and government has more freedom to impose legislation and rules that perhaps the citizens don't agree with.
Even if they vote for it?
I mean, even if they vote for it, I think that the government's role isn't to intervene in people's personal lives in certain aspects.
So there's some areas in our life we don't want the government to be involved no matter what, even if they voted. Mm-hmm. Correct. We live in an age when people talk about democracy so much. Keep in mind, even usually this is not true, but usually totalitarian powers did not come into power through democracy. But the Nazis came to power through an election, series of elections. What the founding fathers believed in limited government is there's some areas you don't want government to touch at all. And I'll give you an example that you can use with your peers that every one of you is going to agree on, I think. And you're not going to say we leave it up to elected officials. And that is in the music you listen to, in the music and entertainment industry. You could argue that some of you have 100 tunes and somebody has thousands. There's great inequality. Some bands get tremendous resources, others just make it by the skin of their teeth. But you don't want government deciding what music you listen to, and your peers do not either. You don't want to go to Dianne Feinstein and Barbara Boxer to lobby for the kind of music that you want. You want that freedom yourself. And there's no reason to turn it over to government, even if it's done on a majoritarian basis. Because most of the music young people through the years would want to listen to would be different than what the majority of the American population wants to listen to, or you wouldn't have the constant turnover of new entertainment, new acts. So if you lock in that the government's going to make these decisions for you in certain areas, it takes away individualism. It takes away, I would say, accountability. And it certainly takes away any aspect of self-governing. So limited government, there are areas with the founding fathers, which the conservative movement believes government should be limited. There's areas government shouldn't touch. That's a big difference between us and the progressives and the liberals. They believe government should control everything. Everything. So, big difference. Any other points you want to bring out that really strong in your group? Haven't been touched on yet. Or anything related to limited government?
Limited government interference in the market.
So, consistent with that is you want... the music example I just gave is probably a good one, right? You don't want the government to say, we're not going to allow this group, we're not going to say that ticket prices have to be a certain amount. There may be differences, you may have complaints about it, but you're still going to have better with freedom in limiting the government in that area and having the government being involved. You have a great name, Reagan. Your fellow students give you a hard time with that name at all?
Not at all.
Works out pretty well?
I come from Southern California, so it's the conservative hub of California, but my government teacher gives me a hard time for it. But
is it he or she?
He.
Do you have any conservative teachers?
Relatively, most of them are not vocal. Mm-hmm. But
they're afraid to speak up, mm-hmm. possibly.
Yes.
Yeah, that's the problem. That's one of the challenges of learning these ideas is... most of the educational process has been taken over by people who do not agree with these principles. Thank you very much, Reagan.
Thank you. Good job.
I got to learn how to do this a little better. Get the microphone. Thank you. All right, who's with the Freedom Group? Well, it's obvious what word you consider to be most important, Joe, right?
Yeah.
Where's your school?
San Jose.
Okay, another Californian.
Yeah.
We have Californians running all these groups? We'll see if we have any non-Californians as we come up. I know we have, 31 states here? How many are from California?
Woo!
How many are not from California?
Yeah.
Okay. How many are afraid to put their hand up one way or the other? No. Freedom. Tell me about freedom. Doesn't the liberals believe in freedom?
You'd think. Our group talked a lot about the founding fathers' principles of freedom found in the Constitution, mainly the first, second, and the rest of the amendments. So one of the things our group talked about is the individual freedom to make choices for yourself, to not have the government automatically sign you up for health care you may not want, the principles of faith, the ability to practice the faith you want, the ability to defend yourself.
You have faith up here? Well, let me zoom.
Importance
of faith. So freedom is tied to faith.
Yes.
I thought the people that believed in, had strong religious beliefs, didn't believe in freedom.
It depends. Our group also talked about...
That's what the left would say.
Yeah.
How would you answer that?
Can you repeat that?
The left often would suggest that if you have strong views on faith, that you are not for freedom for other people. How would you answer that?
You can't really say... I guess an example they bring up is homosexuality, people mm-hmm. bringing that up. And I think it... boils down more to the involvement of the government and the level of that, mm-hmm. and the ability as myself as a personal individual to hold my own beliefs, and for other people who may disagree to hold their beliefs, but that violating someone else's beliefs through the use of government force is not something that should be taken.
So that's a core First Amendment position?
My bad.
Bill of Rights, right, are tied to freedom. You mentioned it. I don't know if you have it up here.
I don't think
Bill of Rights, right? The rights given to us in the Bill of Rights, where did those rights come from?
The Founding Fathers. Is that locked?
The Founding Fathers gave it to us?
Yeah.
So if Madison and...
Well, God-given rights.
God-given rights. And what is the difference between God-given rights and government-given rights?
God-given rights should not be able to be taken away from people.
So government doesn't have the right to take away rights that you as an individual you know, made in the image of God, mm-hmm. have. So the right to worship as you choose, to exercise religion, free speech, those are core, right to assemble, right to petition your government. All of those are under assault by liberals and the left today. But all those go to fundamental rights that the founding fathers believed government didn't have any role in, the federal government at least, had no role in them whatsoever. The federal government shouldn't decide those things for us. We come to the table, we've never given those rights up to the government, barring a constitutional amendment to that effect. And that is tied into including your religious beliefs. There's a key difference today, I just want to alert you to, between the right to free exercise of religion, which conservatives and the founding fathers believed in, and the right to worship. The left today will concede you have a right to worship. But for them, that means basically 1 hour in church or a synagogue or a temple. Free exercise of religion means throughout your life. And so the left today talks about the right to worship, which they basically would limit probably to about 1 hour a week. Free exercise of religion is all the hours in the week, all the hours in your life. So this is tied also to life, liberty, and property, the constitutional rights. Life, liberty, and property, didn't the founding fathers decide not to use that term?
Yeah, they use pursuit. I think they do use it in one place.
Yeah, they use it in a couple places. A lot of times leftist teachers will say, the founding fathers said life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, as though they were rejecting property rights, but it's elsewhere in the Constitution. It's in the Bill of Rights, it's in the 14th Amendment, and the founding fathers viewed the only distinction they made is not everybody had property rights at the time, but they still had the same rights to have it. And so don't let the left make a distinction like the founding fathers didn't believe in property rights. They believed in it so much, they used the term the pursuit of happiness so that those people who didn't have property at that point, but still had the possibility of obtaining it, would be have the same freedoms as the other. Anything else you really want to bring out, Joe?
No, I think that covers
good.
It pretty
thank
well.
You very much. Good. Good job.
Thank you very
thank
much.
Thank you. All right. This group has a few more ideas. Who's the spokesman for this group? William, where are you from? Tennessee.
Yes, sir.
All right. It's good to have no slight to the Californians, but it's good to have a non-Californian up here. So what? Is important to you and your group that wasn't mentioned so far, we haven't highlighted any others.
I'm trying to find it. I know we talked about it. Social mobility.
Social mobility. What do you mean by social mobility?
The ability to raise and lower your class.
To
raise and lower your class on the economic status.
To raise and lower the class that you're in. So could it be economic mobility?
Yes.
Why do you use class?
Well,
what class are you in?
Middle class.
How do you know?
Term of income.
And you make the and what's middle income in the country today?
I think it's over $40,000.
So you make over $40,000? Congratulations. Well done. Well done. Conservatives have tried to avoid the term class. Marx used the term class all the time. You could say wage earners. You could say level of income, but when people start talking classes, the left believes people get locked into classes. And you're probably using the real definition of what you're making right now, you would be in the lower class, right?
Yeah.
Because you're probably not making any money, right?
Well, yeah.
Maybe a little bit, but not middle class yet, right? So-called. So you're a low income earner so far. But where do you see yourself going in your lifetime?
Well, if I put enough work in college, I see myself going up higher.
Being a high income earner, right?
Yes.
Why not, right? You have so many more opportunities. You can help other people. You can do other things in your life, the more income you make. But don't try to avoid class. When the left talks about class, they talk about people getting locked in to certain levels. That's just not true in the United States today. Even when they talk about the highest income class, they would say, is earning more today than, you know, 10 years ago or 20 years ago, which they are earning more than they were 10 years ago, proportionate to the whole population, they may be completely different people than the people 10 years ago. but they imply that they're exactly the same people, the exact same families. So you're absolutely right. They have mobility is an outgrowth of freedom and limited government. Take in the music industry. Who are the top bands today as compared to 5-10 years ago? The top bands 5-10 years ago were probably in some garage making no money, right?
Exactly.
But they're high income earners today. So we have, by having freedom, we have the mobility that you didn't have in the old world, you don't have in socialist countries today. Give me one other value up here that's important to your group.
I think that ties into work for what you get.
Work for what you get. In other words, if you're capable, but you give me, what does that mean in your words?
Like a lot of liberals, they want to give like welfare handouts, and a lot of people who are on welfare are afraid to get jobs because they make more off welfare. That's kind of tying them down to staying on the level. They can't have mobility.
But, you know, if you're going to get, if you can be a middle income earner, just collecting government services, then you can do whatever you want. You can, you can be, have you seen the lobster guy on Fox News? You should Zillow or Google him or whatever. Google him, Zillow. No, Google him. He's got an interesting story. He's totally capable of working. He goes out surfing every day, but they've shown him shopping for lobsters. Other people are paying for him. The idea is that individual responsibility, you have the ability to do that. Does that mean you have no ability, you have no obligation to help other people?
No.
You do have an obligation,
yeah.
Right? Why do you believe you have an obligation to help other people?
The welfare principle, help those who are in need.
And where does that principle come from in your mind?
Where does it come from?
Yeah. Where'd you get that idea?
Where'd I get that idea?
Yeah.
Well, based on me, it goes with my biblical beliefs.
Exactly. So the idea of the need to help other people is tied to faith in our country today. And I would say, in my own view, my own perspective, is I have an obligation to help those that need help. I do have that obligation. But I don't see anywhere in Scripture where I have the obligation to help government do that or have the right to reach into your pocket and take your money and do that. I have that obligation individually. Mm-hmm. I didn't see Jesus, if I may use him as the example, anywhere ever calling for me to give more money, more power to government. Whenever he called for us to do help other people, it was always on an individual basis. This is the core of individualism that was talked about right here in the outset. And there is, I think, a moral obligation to help those. The left tries to exploit that to say it's an opportunity to give government more power. We as conservatives don't believe that. We do believe that you work for what you get, and you do have an obligation, if you're faith-based, probably to help those that are less fortunate.
Mm-hmm.
But I would also suggest the government programs don't do that anyway, that we do it best on our own. Right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good to have someone from Tennessee. That's where we were founded. All right, this group, given at least a number of entries, should be the A group. Did Emily fill out all this, or was it the students in your group? It was the students. Okay, well, who's the spokesperson for this group? I'm not a doubter. I'm not a doubting Thomas. Carter, you guys really were busy, right?
Yes, sir.
But you've been here before, haven't you?
Yes, sir, I have.
Yes, and your sister's been here, right?
She has also
So
been
you,
here.
You've had a head start on all this. So what are some of the most important ideas in here that haven't been picked up so far? Give me a couple to start with.
I think, did we hit on limited government already?
We did, that, yep.
Strong national defense.
Strong national defense. Where do you have that here? This is
the very first one.
Okay,
right there.
Very first one. Tell me what a strong, the left doesn't believe in a strong national defense?
I think they're a little bit more lenient that, like conservatives believe that they should be a fine line that where if, it kind of ties into foreign policy where if someone crosses that line, like, you know that consequences are going to follow with the actions that they did. And that kind of keeps, other countries in shape, but not, liberals kind of say that a strong national defense kind of makes us a warring nation. Mm-hmm. But I would disagree because I believe that it makes us, kind of go out of wars because people know that if they want to go to war with us, we're going to be ready, and they're not really going to, I don't know, be able to progress on that.
Right. So a core concept, you may have had it here, someone else had it in their groups, is peace through strength, right? It was something Reagan talked about, that if the country's strong, it's less likely to be attacked. Some libertarians think that we should have no foreign policy. You are living in one of the most exciting times in American history and in life. You will have a chance probably to travel the world in terms of your economic success and the ability to get you around the world in the years to come. The question is, will you have the freedom to do that? Will other countries think that they can kidnap Americans with impunity? That they can attack American businesses around the world? That they can take you and behead you, or take you and offer you for ransom, or take you and put you into slavery? All things that are being done in the world today. The only way you can have a truly international libertarian society is if we have a strong national defense and an effective foreign policy. Am I being heckled from outside the building? So is that what's going on here? And so strong national defense. When the United States was attacked in December 1941, was our military really strong or not so strong?
Not that strong.
Not so strong. Does anyone believe our military was really strong in December 1941? It was very weak. And the Japanese thought that they could wipe out our carrier force in one strike. They didn't do it successfully, but they thought that. And if we had a really strong military, they probably would not have done that. So the left may claim that they're for a strong national defense. I doubt that they even claim that anymore. But I do think that's a fundamental difference between liberals and conservatives. What else?
States' rights, I think, is pretty important.
States' rights is important. I'm going to challenge you on that one a little bit. Where do you have that? I don't see that here.
Right here.
A lot of conservatives put that down. If I can moderate it a little bit, I would call it federalism, which means all power doesn't reside in the federal government. But I think there's a danger in saying, personally, I think there's a danger in saying just states' rights. And here's why. The left ties states' rights to lost causes. How many believe that states' rights was a fundamental part of the Civil War? How many believe the South believed in states' rights first and foremost? How many believe the North believed in states' rights first and foremost? One, two, maybe three. What led to the Civil War, this is where the left has revised American history, was the Dred Scott decision. The Dred Scott decision was a decision by the US Supreme Court that said a slave, a former slave, who had gone to the state of Wisconsin and then to Illinois, had to be returned to the state of slavery in the South. I forget which southern state, slave state, the slave Dred Scott came from. The northern position, if you will, was that the individual states could make their choice of who was free and who was not. And once a person was in the state of Michigan or state of Illinois, they were a free citizen, or state of Wisconsin. The Southerners wanted the Fugitive Slave Act enforced throughout the entire country, where the federal government would track down a slave anywhere in the country. So if you look back at the beginning of the Civil War, with the exception of the right to secede, it was actually the North that believed in individual states' rights, and it was the South that believed in a unitary national government. It's not taught that way anymore because the left tries to discredit states' rights. And you need to be careful on that issue, because state governments can take away your freedoms just as much as the federal government can. If the national government says that you can only listen to music that we want, you don't want that. But if California says it, you probably don't want that either. And so to some extent, I would contend, Carter, that the idea that we started with today of individualism probably trumps states' rights. That we as conservatives believe in that as a more preeminent position. I'm not trying to totally deconstruct what your group had to say. I'm just warning you that it's a more complicated issue than what was given before. Talk to me about pro-life issues, briefly.
Well, that kind of ties in with kind of religious freedom, I think. because, well, the, I guess, trending topic right now is Planned Parenthood, and that's being funded by public taxes and people's taxes, but yet not everyone agrees with that, and I believe that it should be defunded and be a nonprofit organization. So,
would you want people still funding Planned Parenthood?
Well, it yeah, but on their like not from taxes, like have a nonprofit.
Right. I understand you don't want to be taxed for it, but do you personally want to fund Planned Parenthood?
I do not.
Why not?
I morally disagree with it.
Why?
Because it's a violation of my religious beliefs.
Is it your religious beliefs? Are you the big loser in abortion?
Well, it's against my Christian values, but it doesn't directly affect me.
It may affect God. It may detract from religious values. But who's the biggest loser in an abortion?
The baby?
Exactly. Exactly. It's the child's life being snuffed out. Right? So if you believe in limited government, so the left says, oh, the conservatives are suddenly for big government when it comes to abortion. If you believe in limited government, what did we endow our government to do? Anyone? What was the Founding Father said? We endow our government to do what? To protect what? What are the words they used?
Our right.
Right. Say it. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Life. We endowed our government to protect life. If you believe there's a child and another human being, and everything of modern science tells us it's another human being. That person has his or her own DNA, has their own life potential. It's a separate life. And so if we endowed our government to protect life, that's the fundamental thing. Planned Parenthood, I understand. As far, we don't want, the pro-choice movement wants to give you no choice. You have to fund it no matter what. But the real core reason why we're Right to Life movement is because we believe there's a life that needs to be protected. And when we talk about conservative values in the country today, since the Roe v. Wade decision in 1973, which is totally scientifically and medically outdated now, says you could not sustain life in the second trimester, from 3 months to 6 months, which is not true any longer, that whole decision, since that decision, we've lost 50 million potential Americans. 50 million. The left should be ashamed of themselves. And that is a core conservative principle. Carter, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. You did a good job. All right, the final group. Who's the spokesman for Group E? What is the biggest issues that have been left out in our discussion today? I'm going to have to clip your time, James, and you're from New York, my home state.
An hour and a half south of Buffalo, so.
Well, I came from Buffalo. I came from downtown Buffalo.
Okay.
Grew up in that lovely inner city metropolis.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
You're laughing. They don't understand that it's a joke, but it was a joke on me. That's how I became a conservative. The inner city government was so corrupt. My family was not conservative, but everything in Buffalo seemed to be corrupt. On the governmental level, and that's how I got off and running as a conservative. But what did we not bring out here?
I don't know. I think
in your group,
yeah. There's a lot that we had that has already been spoken about. I guess we sort of talked about the Constitution, but I think all of it.
Now let's talk about the Constitution for a minute. We got limited time. Let's stick with that for just a second or two. What's the critique of the Constitution? If you were progressive or liberal in your high school, what do they say negatively about the Constitution?
I guess it sort of depends on, like say if it were the Second Amendment, well, they had muskets and they didn't have semi-automatic guns, and it's outdated.
So we shouldn't have progressed. We should have just stayed with muskets, and that would have been okay.
Well, that they.
It was a different age.
It's no longer valid.
What was the biggest criticism of the Constitution as a whole in your high school?
Anyone.
You can come back. Yep.
It's outdated.
We want to touch on that. What else? Yes.
How you interpret it.
It's a question of that. What's the biggest criticism of the Constitution? Who wrote it? Old white guys. Anything? We got something against old white guys? Was it just their old white guys? What else about them that makes them subject to criticism? Someone said it. No, that's not it. Slaveholders, right? How many of you believe the majority of the founding of the signers of the Constitution were slaveholders? How many of you think a majority were not slaveholders? A majority were not, by the way. It's outdated and is written by slaveholders. How would you answer that? Take the outdated. What would you say about the outdated part? You were hitting on that with the muskets. Yes.
Well, like you just said, most of them weren't slave owners, so it wouldn't.
Yeah, but on the muskets, how about being outdated? Well, something written 225 years or so ago outdated?
Is it outdated?
Yeah, I'm asking.
I mean, I think it is to them, but I don't think it is. It's outdated because it's a principle that they laid out for our protection. It wasn't necessarily for the guns in particular, so we can protect ourselves from the government.
Let me give you two arguments on the outdated position. The first is the argument the left uses: it was written for a society of 3 million people. Today, we're 300 million people. If government should be limited because the governors, people like Washington, Jefferson, Madison, Adams, John Jay, Alexander Hamilton, if they couldn't govern 3 million people, what chance is there today that Obama, Joe Biden, John Boehner, and Mitch McConnell can tell 300 million people how to live their lives? Madison answered this in the 10th Federalist paper. The more complex a society is, the more the Constitution hits core principles that were correct, which is limited government, because people can decide among themselves what to do. The second I want to give you very quickly is, how old is the Ten Commandments? Right? 4,000 years old? Does it mean it's outdated? Or was it true 4,000 years ago that it's better not to murder someone? Was it true 4,000 years ago it was better not to covet somebody else's wife and goods? Or is it just as true today? Just because a principle is old doesn't mean it's wrong. As far as the slaveholder argument goes, look, our society today is killing 50,000 people, 40,000 now, I guess, on the roads every year. Since 1973, we've aborted 50 million children. Subsequent societies can look back and say, ours was an immoral society. We did all these things. You shouldn't have believed in their principles. Society moved on. Even the founding fathers embedded in their discussion the idea of ending slave trade and slaveholding. That's why there was the section about ending slave trade in the District of Columbia as early as 1818. It should have been ended in 1787, but it was not. But the founding fathers knew they needed to point the country in the direction of ending it. And that was the best they could do and still get a constitution passed that would keep them from being run by the British, who also were at that point still a slave, a society of slave trading. Any other thing you want to add quickly? I'm running a little over time. I don't want to shut you down on anything that you feel really strongly on. hasn't been covered. Anything else?
Let's see. Did someone talk about Common Core? We talked about that a lot.
Common Core follows from some of this, but I want to get the big principles.
I think we covered most of it.
Good. Thank you, James. Good to have someone from Western New York. All right. I'm running a little bit over. This is probably going to be reinforced in the film that you're about to see. These are the core principles of the conservative movement. Individual freedom, which leads to personal accountability, the government taking less. When government at all three levels, sometimes you're going to ask, when you apply to college, they're going to say, you believe in limited government, you don't want government running things, but you want student loan. So you're a hypocrite. You're a hypocrite, Faith. You're going to want a student loan when that time comes. My answer to that is very simple. Government at all three levels takes 43 cents out of every dollar you make and your family makes, state, federal, and local. It's hard to do all the things that you want to do in life if you only get to keep 57 cents out of every dollar. So what do you naturally do? You fight to get a share of the 43 cents back. And the left uses that argument to say, aha, you believe in more government. That doesn't mean you believe in more government. You want to make this 57 cents 90 cents. The good Lord only asked for 10%. Government shouldn't ask for more than 10%. So don't buy the argument because you're for getting part of that 43 cents back that you're a hypocrite. We believe in limited government, self-government as much as possible, keeping the government out of running music and other businesses. We believed in the Bill of Rights, the importance of faith in our society, faith and family. Other people picked up family on their boards. Work for what you get. We believed in a strong national defense. We believe in federalism with local control over federal control. That doesn't always mean a tough ideological position on states' rights, but it does mean trying to make those decisions locally as often as you can. We believe in the right to life. We believe in the freedoms and the principles of the Founding Fathers. If you understand that, you've got the essence of the modern-day conservative movement. It is a label, but don't hesitate to use a label. Thank you very much. Sorry, I ran a couple minutes over.